I think you'd have to maybe look at one of the most famous examples of how this sort of protectionism, this economic nationalism, can have unintended consequences both domestically and in the global economy. And I think the famous one from that is the infamous Smoot-Hawley tariff of 1930. This is this protectionist tariff that was passed by the Hoover administration, perhaps in part to help create a safety net around the United States economy, American industries, amidst this growing depression that had just struck. But one of the unintended consequences of that is that it made enemies out of America's trading partners. So one good example of this is Italy, where the United States had been exporting numerous cars, they had manufacturing plants in Italy, and then American cars started getting attacked by the Italians on the streets. They started not buying American cars, boycotting them. American car companies essentially had to go out of business, and American sales to Italy plummeted drastically.
But surely today we're obviously in a very, very different environment because of that supply chain effect. Nothing is purely made in the US, purely made in Italy, purely made in China. There are components that you have to source from all of these different countries. Again, this is a good example of a week where China said that they were going to reduce tariffs on US auto imports. The best beneficiaries have been European car makers, it's been the German car makers because of that supply chain effect. And so today, when you look at it, I think all leaders obviously are aware of the supply chain effect. And even Donald Trump, President Trump, has said, we will make exceptions for companies like Apple because they are most likely to get impacted due to the chip maker, due to the contents. So when you think about it from a historical framework, do you not take into consideration that today, the way things are manufactured is very different from how it was 100 years ago?
It is in many ways. I mean, we are clearly in a more globalized economy than we were before. But that's not to say that many of those same issues weren't at play in the 1930s. American cars were, you know, however many, you know, 50% of what was going in an American car in the 1930s was probably coming from rubber from South Asia as well. So these supply chains were certainly an issue back then too. That was, you know, I think one of the problems that we run into here is that it's very easy to see emotionally even when jobs are lost because of say some sort of outsourcing of jobs, right? Your company goes bust and you lose your job. It's much less easy to see these very complex supply chains that you're pointing to, these global supply chains. It's very difficult to see those jobs that are created because of those. And so I think that's why oftentimes economic nationalists tend to have the upper hand when it comes to politics.
You've mentioned how protectionism is often a precursor to trade war. It's often a driver that creates the motivation to try to enact policies that protect a nation. Does protectionism tend to come in cycles, and is it inevitable that protectionism results in a trade war, or is there another route out of this?
I don't think it always inevitably will lead to a trade war. I think it tends to when you have a country as powerful economically as the United States implementing it, where protectionism will adversely impact industries in other countries in a way that they will definitely notice. That might not happen with a smaller country that enacts protectionism. But these trade wars tend to come from countries like the United States enacting it, and this is actually part of America's protectionist past. Ever since the Republican Party was founded in the 1850s, it's been the party of protectionism, and out of that came a series of trade wars with Canada, with Britain, obviously with a variety of European states after the Smoot-Hawley tariff in the 1930s. And oftentimes from these trade wars too creates geopolitical conflict, very unintended geopolitical conflict.
Hi, I'm Giovanna Bersecci, and thank you for watching. You can check out more of our videos by clicking on the boxes on the screen. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more from CNBC International. Thank you for watching.